Modern EVs and HEVs are something like a data center on wheels. But rather than sitting in a climate-controlled warehouse, these vehicles put components through a veritable torture test of mechanical and environmental extremes. If there was basic training for components, Daniel West of AVX would be the drill sergeant screaming at components to make sure there were no major malfunctions. Instead, he's here to talk about the unique products AVX offers that provide the performance and durability needed in EVs and HEVs. Welcome to Tech Chats, Daniel.
Hi, Chris. Thank you for having me. Glad to be here.
All right. Now, before we dive into the different areas of the vehicle, let's first talk about the challenges and requirements of designing for an EV or an HEV.
So for EV, HEV, from the voltage side of it, we're going to be looking at higher voltages than the internal combustion engines, the 12-volt lines. We're going to see 48-volt lines. We're going to see even higher voltages for resonant coupled charging. We're going to still see those same miniaturization effort, decreasing the weight in vehicles. When we're talking about communications, still need that signal integrity, having all the benefits that passive components can provide, but in as small as package as possible. And we're on a budget too, so those are the things that the designers are going to be faced with.
So can you talk about some of the different applications within the vehicle?
AVX has a large portfolio of passive devices, but wanted to focus on just today capacitors and multilayer varistors. The way I want to bring those in is just focus on five different applications. Those were active body control. We're going to talk about motors in there and how the inductive switching elements, they can cause a wide range of transients. We're going to have different size motors. So, of course, the energy content in those transients is going to be highly variable. What we want as a good solution is protect our ICs, our controllers. We're going to want a series of parts that can cover a wide range of transients. And then for powertrain, we really need to isolate the battery and the drivetrain there. And we're going to talk about a very high reliability, high current handling film capacitors. And then for lighting, for EV, HEV, designers are going to want to think about their overall electrical load. A way that you can reduce that is using LEDs. And to get the nice feature of dimming effect, you can use pulse width modulation. So I'm going to talk about our polymer capacitors that are stable across voltage and temperature. And then it doesn't have to be for LED lighting, but it could be any pulse width modulating circuit for alarms or chimes. The polymers would have no audible noise involved. For ADAS modules, obviously these are going to be very complex. The processor cores are going to be running at very high speeds, and what we want out of our decoupling capacitors is low inductance. What that provides for designers is the ability to reduce the number of decoupling capacitors for one, and that indirectly, increases your reliability. Reduces your bill of materials, your BOM. So I do want to talk about our low inductance capacitors. On power conversion and drive control, for power supplies, resonant coupled charging, we're going to be looking at high voltages with EV and HEV. More electronics are coming, more modules are being installed, more motors, more electric motors. We still want that miniaturization of our passive components, but high voltage devices, they really need to be large. The electric field is much more intense, and I'm going to talk about how you still can achieve smaller packages because of the quality of materials used, the designs on the electrodes of our high voltage ceramic, how they really enable these capacitor and voltage ranges in our leaded and surface mount devices.
So then let's talk about power conversion and drive control.
Okay. So I'm going to go into a little bit about MLCC design. You can see on the images there to the right, the 20 microns, that's the dielectric thickness there. And then you can see these small bands in between the dielectric. Those are the actual electrodes. And from a high voltage part to a miniature part on the right, you're going to see the amount of layers that can be included in a given package, which affects our capacitance that we can provide. We're going to get much more cap if we have added layers. But layers being so thin, we can't get as high of a voltage part. The electric field will break down the dielectric at that point. So from a capacitor MLCC design standpoint, we have to consider the thickness of the dielectric for one, but also our electrodes. Our electrodes are uniform and consistent throughout its area and then its thickness. to accommodate those high voltages that is controlled in the process, and also using superior materials so that we can achieve those high voltages, use a dielectric that has a K that'll give you a wide range of cap, and also be able to withstand that electric field at those voltages. And then you can see the image on the left, the illustration. We see where the electrodes are attached to the termination, and then the electrode comes out. That distance between the termination and then the electrode is called the electrode margin. That's where most of the electric stress is for MLCCs. And so what we have is a tightly controlled process. You can see the dielectric layers there. We want to keep it as dense as possible. We don't want it to be porous. Controlling our processes, putting into a package that's small. So with our leader devices, we have our SV series and then our high voltage auto MLCC surface mount are there.
And then moving from the high voltage to the high current of the powertrain, what designers need to look for there?
Designers are going to need to look for high reliability. And our film caps, they have a thin metallization layer. And on the on the top right, you can see that there's a very small element that is attaching the one square of the electrode to the other, you know, to the rest of the grid of the electrode. And those are tiny fuse elements. And what they will do is, in the presence of a overvoltage or if it gets real hot and you can't handle the current, those fuses will evaporate, and then it will isolate that one capacitor element from the rest of the capacitor. What this means is that the failure mode here that we see in film capacitors is that it just reduces cap. On our film capacitors, we have seen zero catastrophic failures on 450 types of parts. They have totaled 317 billion hours of life. And these part voltages are, their ratings go from 75 volt to 5.5 kilovolt. These don't dry out. They're a dry formula, a robust alternative to aluminum electrolytics. We don't see a bathtub curve like we do on in terms of reliability. And we do thermal models on our film capacitor modules and can very accurately determine life. Over the life of the program, you know, you're going to have a wide range of temperatures. You know, we can accurately model the reliability there. And in this design, we can get high currents out, you know, for the, you know, for powertrain. They're going to be running, you know, high voltages and high level of current. And, you know, most importantly, what we're going to want there is reliability. And the film capacitors are a very desirable alternative to aluminum electrolytics.
So then moving on to the active body control, and you mentioned earlier you want to talk about your transguard multilayer varistors. What do designers need to look for when they're dealing with those active body motors and those other applications there?
For any motor, when it turns off, we're going to get some voltage and current going back into the circuit from the inductive element stopping. You know, that voltage can't be regulated fast enough. So, you know, TVS diodes are ubiquitous. They're used everywhere. They're really easy to design in. But the multilayer varistors are, I have a cross section there. You can see that it's, you know, identical to an MLCC. And in fact, the processes are exactly the same. It's just a slightly different material set used. We're going to dope the ceramic grains with a zinc oxide barrier to give it that semiconductor nature. And, you know, at its clamping voltage, the varistor is going to shunt current to ground. It's going to protect your IC, your load, whatever is the sensitive device. And it does it efficiently in a, you know, standard EIA, you know, MLCC package. So the benefit there in being an alternative to a diode is that it's per volume much more efficient than a diode to suppress transients. If we compare the design of a multilayer varistor to the design of a leaded varistor, which have been used in the past and maybe have seen some failures due to wear out. Well, the multilayer varistor takes on the benefits of MLCC processing and production. And so what we're going to see with varistors is that the grains are, the physical sizes are uniform, and the actual layers are tightly controlled. The firing processes are the firing profiles. The temperature profiles is more consistent, and the materials are superior. And what we're going to see is, you know, compared to a traditional leaded varistor that was used in the past, we're going to see reliability go up on the multilayer varistor design because of the consistent grain structure. In the presence of a of a transient, those grains, and then the barrier layer, when they're activated during a transient, it provides a really convoluted network of current paths, and it dissipates that energy, and it can do it many times for back-to-back transients if there were. They're just more robust. The multi-layer design gives it that property when compared to leader resistors, and then the multi-layer design when compared to a TVS diode, we're going to have that internal volume included in the overlapping electrodes. That internal volume dissipating that energy of a transient is much more efficient than a TVS diode, where on a TVS diode, you're going to have a single plane, single PN junction area dissipating that energy. Another benefit that varistors have is that they don't derate across temperature. They are, if they're rated to suppress 1 joule of transient energy at minus 55 to 125. At 125, it's still going to suppress 1 joule. TVS diodes typically derate starting at, above room temperature. So when you are comparing datasheet specifications to varistor for a diode, and you have a motor controlling the seat, and you're deciding on which component to use, we should also consider the performance over temperature of our TVS.
Earlier you alluded to some of the requirements in ADAS, which is obviously applicable across all types of vehicles. Can you talk a bit more about your low inductance MLCCs?
The low inductance MLCCs, or LICC, we have a ACQ200 qualified line of ceramic that really enable the performance of the high-speed cores for ADAS. There's no question that these modules are going to be running at high speeds. They need to be high performance, and in terms of high-frequency decoupling, for your decoupling caps, it's common to see 3 or 4 parallel MLCCs, at different cap values to filter out the noise. And so with an LICC, you're going to be able to have that equivalent decoupling that you had with 4 components into 1. And we do that by changing where the device is terminated. It's also known as reverse geometry MLCCs. And what that provides us is the inductive loop created by the electrodes and the terminations, and then being on the board, that physical loop area is smaller on a low inductance part. We can use a low inductance ceramic to reduce the number of components that we have for decoupling, and that indirectly decreases the number of solder joints we have. It's less weight. That affects your reliability. There's, less components that could fail, and your designs will also be smaller.
And then let's talk about lighting and the different considerations that designers need to have there.
Yeah, for lighting, I wanted to switch gears a little bit and talk about our Tantalum polymer devices. For EV, HEV, we're going to want to reduce our overall electrical load. And a great way to do that is to use LEDs. And we want the fancy feature of having the dimming effect on the lights after you get in the car. If you use pole level modulation to achieve that, if you're using MLCCs, class 2 MLCCs like X7R, X5R, those waveforms on a PWM, they will cause audible noise on the MLCCs from 2 kilohertz to 20 kilohertz. You're going to be able to hear it, and it's very undesirable. And a tantalum polymer is not piezoelectric, won't create that sound, but it's also stable across voltage and temperature as well. You can see in the graph there, it has a broad self-resonant frequency. That's ES. SR right there, but impedance as well. It's very flat, on the bottom there. It doesn't have that V shape that we see in MLCCs. MLCCs are very symmetrical. We saw earlier the dielectric thicknesses are uniform. The electrode lengths are uniform. It's very geometric and symmetrical. The way tantalum polymer capacitors are manufactured is we have, just like MLCCs, we have grains of tantalum, and those are sintered together, and those create a very porous network. The surface area on tantalum capacitors is really huge. For a 10 microfarad, we're going to see something like 600 square centimeters. That goes through a process of electrolysis, and the tantalum pentoxide dielectric is very thin. And then we put a layer of polymer on top of that. Those grains, and then the complex network of the sintered process creates a very convoluted network for current to flow. And that's why we see that broad frequency response. The conductive polymer is used to provide low ESR. It provides an eighth of the ESR as standard tantalum, or the manganese oxide tantalum devices. So those are the benefits we're going to get out of that for, you know, pulse modulation. For lighting, we're going to reduce our overall electrical load. We're going to be efficient on power.
All right, Daniel. Well, before we close this up, is there anything else that you'd like to bring up to our viewers?
Just real quick to wrap up, mentioned earlier, AVX does have a large portfolio of passive electronic components. We have supercapacitors for battery supplement for the, you know, the peak power assist, energy capturing, regenerative braking. Supercaps are good. We have standard passive antennas and also custom antennas for RF modules. And then the passive devices that you can make your filtering network there, whether it's film or RF ceramic capacitors and inductors. We have custom connectors as well. In addition to multi-layer varistors for circuit protection, we also have ESD safe ceramics. They're rated for the standard IEC ESD levels for the non-critical applications that may need some transient protection.
Okay, well, thank you, Daniel, for sharing some insight on how the right components can solve automotive design challenges, especially with all the electronics in EVs and HEVs. If you'd like to learn more about AVX's capacitors, MLVs, and other components, and how they can help in your next design, click the link in the description or visit Mouser.com. And be sure to check back soon for the next episode of Tech Chats.